see if this works. I'm not sure if it will. And I may have to scroll down again to see comments. But I figured out at least that you can see and hear me, and hopefully coming in like this, the sync, the lip syncs back, because that can be really annoying too. So let's see if I can see anybody in the comments section. Nope. Let me go down the bottom, see if there's anyone around. This is crazy. Yada, yada, yada. Okay. Lynn, Max, Danielle, Kirsten. So there are people there. What I'm going to do.
This is crazy.
Hold on a second. Is watch the comments on another computer.
Thank you.
And then I think we can get going. Third time lucky, says Kelly. This is seriously a bit of a gosh. Okay, I'm going to try and do it this way. Hi Sheila. Hi Katya. Lip sync. Yay. All right. I'll try and move this so you're not looking at the side of my head the whole time. Bloody hell. Talk about having to be a little bit adaptable. Goodness gracious me, Facebook. Oh, thank you for the hearts. I'm feeling a bit like, holy moly. All right. Okay. So, hi everyone, and thank you so much for coming. I can see Pat there too, and thank you for putting up, Bernie, Carly, for putting up with this hoo-ha. No idea what's going on. I have my resident geek duck with me, and he's got no idea what's going on. So you know, if he's an IT professional and he can't figure it out, then we don't know what's happening with Facebook today, with the setup of the live streaming. But what I wanted to come on today to talk to you about is I wanted to talk about getting out of the story abyss, because I know from working with you all and from hanging out with lots of authors over the years and that this story abyss thing is a really big deal. Okay, it's a really big deal. And so the first thing I want to do is talk about, what is the story abyss? Now, I did a video about this quite a few years ago on YouTube, and I must dig through and see if I can find that video again. But the way I love to describe it, and I love teaching this in real life, because I've got a whiteboard and I can do a drawing. But basically, there comes a time in every story where it's like a canyon. So you start off on the flat and you're walking into your story. So you imagine this little guy or girl walking along towards their story, and everything's going okay because it's just the setup. And you're walking along, and you can actually see, in some ways, you can see the other side of the story. You don't necessarily know the ending, but you kind of know where you're going. Right? When you set out, you kind of know where you're going and the end is in sight. But then what happens, and what I want to get across today really, really strongly, is this happens in every single story to every single writer. I've never known anyone who hasn't experienced this and doesn't continue to experience it with every new story. So there comes a time when you start to take this downward descent. All right. And it's like you're going into a canyon. And at first you think, oh, you know, this is okay. This is okay. I've still got control. And then at some point you're in there. You're down in the canyon. You're in the abyss. And not only are you down in the canyon with all the wild animals and the wolves and all the things that are going on, and you're feeling like you're in a jungle of vines and it's all pulling you under, you also lose sight of the other side. You lose sight of the end. You lose sight of where you're going with the story. Now, this is the time when, I'm just looking at comments over here, this is the time when most aspiring authors who've never been through this before bail. All right, this is when the inner critic gets its most strongest, because this is where you start to doubt your talent, you start to doubt your ability, you think that you can't do it, you think you blame the story. This is also the point where writers go for the next shiny thing. They think, this is too hard, I've got the wrong story, I'm gonna start a new story, all right? And they bail. But what happens is the new shiny story at some point leads them back into the canyon, leads them back into the abyss. And so what a lot of aspiring and emerging and developing and established authors, because I do this myself, I keep doing it, have is a whole lot of half-written stories. And I would bet that if I was to come in and look through those manuscripts, I'd say every one of those stories that's been abandoned has been abandoned in the abyss, okay, while the writer is down there grappling. And it's all a tangle. So what we need to do, and what those of us who actually manage to finish stories actually do, is we find a way to survive and to claw our way out of the abyss. Now, I'm not suggesting that this doesn't happen in picture books, because I know a lot of you are kid-led authors, so this happens in picture books too, but I am today talking about longer pieces, all right? But you can take what I'm saying today and definitely adapt it to PBs, because even a PB that's 500 words, there's still an abyss in the middle of it. You know, there's still a period where you lose sight of what you're trying to do and it all gets a bit messy and ugly. Okay, so we can adapt this to PBs, but I am talking today most more about longer pieces. The other thing I want to add to this is that there can be a number of abysses in a novel. All right, so I don't want anyone to think, "Whew, I got through that. Now it's going to be smooth sailing," because that's not necessarily what's going to happen. And I don't want you to be shocked if it happens again and again. If you keep falling down into this spot, keep losing sight. Okay, this can be quite a regular occurrence throughout a novel. But again, those of us who finish our novels and finish writing our books are the ones that have figured out ways of negotiating, of navigating, of getting through this abyss, and of accepting that it's part and parcel of being a writer. It's part and parcel of inventing stories. Kester says, her abyss has, in this story, has happened at chapter 2. Now that's depressing, isn't it? That's a little bit early for the abyss. Shouldn't happen so soon. Yeah, putting rules on it. Shouldn't happen so soon. Why not? You know, why not? It does. It can happen that soon. Hi, Gemma. Nerida knows the abyss well, and you've got to hang in there. Catch is rewriting her way through an abyss, and has had a great number of them. Now, what got me really thinking more about the abyss too was because we were talking recently, or I was talking to somebody about where I was at, and I realized that, you know, I was ready to run off and work on something new after having this conversation with my publisher. And suddenly I realized that I actually had three stories in the abyss, three new books, and each of them were in the abyss. And for some reason, I didn't see it. I was telling myself, oh, I'm just playing around with ideas. But what I was actually doing was developing them to the abyss. All right, I was bringing them to the abyss and then going, oh, that's too hard. Let me try something new. Still, you know, 25 years onwards, still thinking that I can find the magical story that doesn't have an abyss or in a canyon or a pothole. You know, still believing that I could find that story if only I went to the next shiny thing. All right, so then I realized that I had to go back to one of the and select one of those stories, you know, and see it through, because that's how you grow as a writer. Okay, so hi, Michelle. Hi, Rory. And Rory's hearing it. What's Bernie got to say? I'm writing PB texts with less than 200 words, so it's quite challenging to extend the story arc and find the climax and resolve within the limited word count. Yes. Yeah, it's not easy. And Kelly says she reckons she's got about 15 stories in the abyss. It's just, it's pretty depressing, isn't it? All right. So I've written down, I've taken some notes here about three ways that I can help you. And what I want to say is these three ways are tried and true. Like this is not an academic discussion of how you might get out of the abyss. Hi, Michelle Mooch. G'day. I use this. This is what I use to get out of the abyss. All right. So this is tried. These are tried and true tips. Okay. So I hope some of you have got pens and paper. Hopefully this is recording too, and we'll just leave it in the mainstream. And, you know, I might put it up onto the Girl and Duck YouTube channel too, so that people have got that. And Rory says, maybe something about a fish who is alone in the deep, dark ocean can no longer see the light. Exactly. All right. So tip number one is all about when you're down in the abyss, standing back a little bit and asking yourself some what I call power questions. All right. These are the it's a time for power questions. So last week we had a amazing masterclass with Deb Abella in the Duck Pond, and Deb was talking about this kind of thing. She was talking about getting in the tangle, getting in the mess, getting in the middle of the story and not being able to see your way out. And Deb's question, which is something that I've used myself, was really wonderful. And I'm going to use Deb's question as an example for you, because it might be a question that really resonates. And then I'm going to give you the one that I always use as well. Okay, so Deb's question when you get stuck in the abyss was, you need to ask yourself, what is my story about? It sounds really simple, all right? But it's actually really tricky. You need to be able to articulate quite succinctly. And of course, Deb's drawing on writing for television and screenplays and that sort of thing. So they're really about log lines and that kind of thing, really getting to the essence of what a story is about. Okay. So you need to be able to ask yourself, what is my story about? But then you need to take it one step further. And this is where you start to get more clarity. And you need to ask yourself, what is my story really about? What's it really about? And sometimes we don't know this until we get into the abyss. All right. It's part of the problem solving. Once we're in the abyss, the abyss is actually teaching us about our story. It's teaching us what we're trying to do, because it's forcing us to get clarity. So, for instance, I took this idea of what is my story about and what is it really about, and I applied it to the first book in the Truly Tan series, just to see how, to give you an example of how this might work. So for me, Truly Tan is about a 9-year-old girl who moves from the city to the country. That's what it's about. Okay, that's the essence. That's just the basic what the story is about. But what it's really about, it's really about a 9-year-old girl who fancies herself as a detective, moves from the city to the country, becomes embroiled in a ghostly mystery, and makes new friends along the way. Okay? See how it's richer, but it's still really tight. I'm still really focused on that protagonist, because it's the protagonist's story. Okay, so we're reining it all in and seeing what this story is really about. And then when you're in the tangle, you can start to push away all the stuff that isn't related to this through line. These power questions are always about helping you find the through line in your story. And I don't want you all to be worried about narrative arcs and climaxes and resolutions and all those sorts of things when you're just still trying to find the through line and clutch onto that again. Because once you've got that through line, you should be able to use that to haul yourself out, or to haul yourself forward with focus and clarity. So we're sort of, yeah, when we're getting rid of all the dross, we're getting rid of all the cul-de-sacs and one-way streets and all that kind of stuff, and we're getting out of there. We're finding our through line again, which we lose. It's normal to lose it. It's healthy to lose it. It's what happens when you're a writer. No matter whether you're a plotter or a pantser or everything in between, you can't control stories. There's a moment, there's a time when you just cannot control stories. They're tricksters. All right. So these power questions are about helping you find your through line. So hi Andra, and Jacinta. And this is good. So that's one way of looking at it. Thanks to Deb and Bella. Thanks, Deb. and the question that I always use is very similar to this, and it's the results are the same. It's about finding the through line. But I always ask myself, what is my protagonist's dramatic need? And I talk a lot about dramatic need when I do masterclasses and in-house, scribbles masterclasses and all that sort of stuff. Because dramatic need is so important that we understand what our protagonist's dramatic need is at some point in the story. Okay? And as we're going and fine-tuning our story, the protagonist's dramatic need becomes clearer to us. It becomes crystallized. It can be kind of murky at the beginning. But the more we write into our story, the more we can get a sense of what that dramatic need is. And of course, the dramatic need is the thing that causes the drama. It's the thing that your protagonist needs the most and will go to all ends to get. And in doing that, they're providing the drama of the story. And of course, as a writer, your job is to block them from achieving their dramatic need, because therein lies the rub. Therein lies the drama. Okay, so for me, it's always about, for me to get to that through line again when I've lost it, it's always about reconnecting with my protagonist's dramatic need. So that dramatic need might be something, it could start out as something as basic as they need to survive, or they need to escape. But then it could be something that could be emotional and psychological things that come in with that as well. They need to find a way through grief or to deal with grief. They need to learn how to deal with their loneliness. In a children's book, it could be they need to make a friend and figure out how to do that. That can be their dramatic need. So, and with a dramatic need, you can have a reluctant hero. You can have a who won't sort of go on the journey, and you've got to push them as a writer, keeping in mind, what you want them to learn, what you want them to achieve, what sort of dramatic need you're pushing onto them. So that's what the first tip I want to give you is that when you're down in the abyss, sit back and ask yourself some power questions. Do not expect an immediate answer. Okay, this can take a lot of time to untangle and figure out, even with this guidance. I think people tend to think these things are quick fixes, and when they're not quick fixes, they blame themselves. All right, but we must be patient while we're unpicking and untangling and getting the devil's ivy. Is that what it was in Harry Potter? getting that unwrapped from around your legs and setting yourself free again to keep writing. So what is my story about? What is my story really about? And what is my protagonist's dramatic need? There's some really, really key questions for you to ask yourself. All right, now the other one, the second one I want to give you, I just need to have a drink. Let me have a look. Nerida's talking about excellent resources. Thank you, Nerida. Number two. Okay. Now, this is something that I do, and I shared this just the other day somewhere. I might have been in Scribbles, a live call. I can't remember. But for me, there's a time when I need a bird's eye view of my story. I need to be able to literally stand above my story and look down on it. And so what I do is I get a A3 pad, And I write on the A3 pad, you know, I break it up into boxes, and each box represents a chapter. And then I will scribble in that chapter what's the key thing that's happened in that chapter. Okay, I'll just get this overall look thing, and I string it out. And so if it's a novel that's got like 16, you know, I'm up to like chapter 16 or something, I will go over very, you know, multiple sheets of A3. Now, some people, I'm looking here to see if I've got cards. The 5x7 cards, I think that's what, the 5x3 cards, they can work too, but for me, I like the A3. I don't know why, it just works better for me to have that A3. But you can do scene blocks onto cards as well and write them. But for me, the key to this is the physicality of it. Don't try and do this on the computer. You know, try to get your body engaged with your story and write these things by hand. Now, I haven't got the science behind why this works, but there's something about having this bodily engagement with your story and being able to stand back and look down on it that feeds your subconscious. Now, I'm not saying for one second that when I get everything laid out and I look down on it, it's an aha, eureka moment, I've solved the problem. What I am saying is that bird's eye view somehow feeds my subconscious, right? So once I've seen that story laid out, I can then walk away from it and maybe go into the garden or go and have a shower or just do nothing and let my subconscious take over, because I've fed it this new image of the story. And then quietly the subconscious tends to work in the background and start sifting through things. And then at some point there's this, oh, I know what I can do. Oh, I know how I can change that up. I know what's needed there. I know why that's dragging there. Okay. But it's this bird's eye view on the A3 sheet that really gives me those really amazing insights that can help me climb out of that abyss and sort things out again. The bird's eye view can work in tandem with the power questions. So they're feeding off each other. Okay, so that can be a really, really terrific way of sorting yourself through the abyss. Power questions and overviews. Now, just an aside there, because I love talking about A3 sketch pads and sheets, I use this for action scenes. All right, but I use it in a different way for action scenes. For action scenes, I literally draw what's going on. So I draw, you know, not like an illustrator, stick figures, okay? I block it out like a stage. It's like doing a play. I'm blocking out what's going on so that I know, you know, the toad's there, the imp's there, the fairy's over there. You know, we're talking about kidlit here. All right, so I know where everybody is at the time of the climax and the confrontation, or the confrontations and the battles. So I need to know where everybody is so that I can write with authenticity, and I can for editing purposes and continuity and all that sort of stuff. So, you know, your sketch pad is your friend when you're an author, especially when you're getting to these bigger pieces. But again, you can use it for a PB as well, and I have done. All right, so that's just a little aside with your bird's eye view of your story. Number three, I've left for last because this is the most, it's kind of the most esoteric, but it's I think the most important. And the most important thing is that it's about your mindset. You must decide that you're going to claw your way out of the abyss. If you don't make that decision, then you're going to keep procrastinating. You're going to keep running after the next shiny thing. You're going to end up constantly with half finished pieces everywhere. You have to get to a point where you decide that it's make or break time. I'm going to finish this story. I'm going to choose one out of the plethora that I've got there of half finished things, and I'm going to see this one through. I'm going to see this one through, because in seeing it through, you will learn so much about yourself as a writer. You will learn how to finish a book. You'll learn what's involved in that. You'll hone a whole lot of new skills. But more importantly, you will come out of that feeling 10 foot tall because you've actually finished. And when you finish, that does such amazing things for your self-esteem as a creator. Now, there's two resources I want to give you in terms of getting you to that point where you make that decision, that really big decision to see things through. And the first one is the one I'm always harping on about, is The Artist's Way. If you don't have it, get it, all right? And keep dipping into the various essays in here that will help you. But there's also another book that I have heard about a gazillion times and only finally got around to getting this week that I want to share with you too. And it's called The War of Art. Break Through the Blocks and Win Your Inner Creative Battles by Stephen Pressfield. Now, for my money, The War of Art and The Artist's Way are the yin and yang of mindset for storytellers. Okay? And there'll be times when you need to go gently and you need the more feminine approach to your, and fluid approach to your creativity. And that's when Julia Cameron, The Artist's Way, will save your ass. Or hold you close, okay? But there's other times when you need to give yourself a kick up the bum. And the War of Art is designed to do that. All right, it's short, it's sharp, it's extremely masculine in its energy. He talks endlessly about resistance and how that manifests in our lives, and how self-drama, all the things. He talks about self-drama, and Julia talks about crazy makers. It's all the kind of the same things, the things that we use, the things that we get involved with in order to put ourselves off, to stop ourselves from creating. So this is a really short, sharp, succinct kick in the bum, but I highly, highly recommend this. I don't think any writer out there should not have these two books, at least. These are the bedrock. You know, if you can't get on top of your mindset, then all the other learning is just learning. It's just extraneous stuff. It's just knowledge, you know. You have to be in the right mindset to be able to apply all the knowledge that you're gleaning from all the different masterclasses and all the different other technical books that you're reading. The thing that needs to happen is you need to get your mindset straight. And you will keep falling off the wagon, and that's why you need to keep coming back to these sorts of things. All right, so that's my three tips today. Ask yourself power questions, get a bird's eye view of your story, and get in charge of your mindset. Keep addressing your mindset, keep working on it, dedicate yourself to it. Remembering that also, one of the things that I'm always saying to you all is that as a writer, you are a problem solver, all right? And there are myriad problems to solve as a writer. And when you come to those problems, I really want you to recognize them as problems and not label them as a failing or a lack of talent or a lack of ability. Every single writer, no matter where they're at in their career, comes to many, many problems in their stories, and it's their job to solve them, whether it's to make it more exciting, whether it's to up the tension, whether it's to get out of the abyss, whether it's to twist things around and get more surprises in there, get more energy in it. These are all problems, all right? They're all problems, and we as writers and artists, we're called on to solve those problems. So no worries, Kester. And Bernie Barker's got another one, Creative Habit by, oh, I've heard of that one too. Creative Habit by Twyla Tharp. Yeah, I've heard about that one. It's got no diagrams, yeah. You know, we're all addicted to these sorts of books. We all have, behind me, you know, apart from all my own books and Harry Potter, behind me there's just stacks of craft, books on the craft, not on witchcraft. the craft of writing, you know, and art. There's loads of them there. But for me, you know, when it's really getting down to your mindset, which is the thing that's going to get you through, you know, getting your head in the right spot, getting to the point where you genuinely prioritize your creativity and your writing, and you see it for what it is, like this incredible gift, and this amazing calling and a lot of friggin' hard work. See it for what it is and dedicate yourself to it. You know, these are the books that will help you do that. These will help you do that. All right. So that's what I wanted to run by you today. And I'm sorry about the beginning and all the hoo-ha with Facebook, but we did it anyway. We did it. What do we got? 2:46. So I'm just going to have a little look here. Katya needed this today. Katya, you need it every day, don't you? Like you need this stuff nearly every day. As I said, I had myself three stories in the abyss and was still conning myself that it was only because I hadn't hit on the right thing that I couldn't finish them. But the truth was I was scared. You know, I was running scared. I was in the abyss and it was all too hard. And I lost faith in my talent and my ability to get out there. Yeah, thanks, Jacinta. And Bernie was a great pick-me-up. It's really cool. All right, just to finish off, most of you are in the duck pond and know about the duck pond, but there's probably people who are watching and not commenting perhaps. So I just wanted to share with you again that the duck pond is open this weekend. If you want to join us, please do. We're open until tomorrow night. That's Monday, April the 19th. We're open till 10 o'clock tomorrow night. The shop's open. It's been lovely seeing new people come in. We always love having new people join our community. It's really, really exciting time for us as we grow this incredible resource. It's unique. I haven't been able to find anything like the duck pond around the world in terms of kid lit. I think where we're headed is very, very exciting. I can see a really great future for this group and as a resource and as a support system for you all, as a way to learn about not just writing, but how to manage your career and your adventure as a writer and illustrator. Everything is going on in there. And of course, one of the key things that I'm so proud of is that we're bringing in loads of other mentors for you. So it's not just me giving you my experience, it's other writers and illustrators as well. So that's what's making the journey and our time spent in the duck pond so incredibly nurturing and supportive, is all these other beautiful creators that are coming in and teaching us once a month. So we've got coming up next month in May, we've got Karen Foxley. That is going to be such an amazing, Kelly says the duck pond is the best. Karen Foxley, and she's going to be not only talking about creating amazing characters, hello, who better than Karen to talk about that sort of thing. She's also going to be talking about something that we don't see discussed that much, and she's going to talk about the juggle between becoming an author and while still having a job in the mainstream. So a lot of you would know that Karen for a long, long time was working full time as a nurse while she was developing her writing on the side. All right. So she's going to talk about how she did that and how she managed that. And I'm going to be there with bells on because I'm fascinated by how people manage that juggle. It's very real. Okay. And it can be ongoing forever. You know, writing, as you all know, is not a high paying job. For the most part. So for a lot of us, we do have to keep throughout our journey. We have to keep finding other ways to make a living as well. So Karen's going to be on in May. Then in June we've got Gus Gordon. So the illustrators out there are going to go off their nuts. But Gus, I'm not sure what Gus's class is called yet. We haven't put that one in yet, but I'm sure Gus is going to be talking about writing and illustrating. I've also flagged with him and asked him to touch on collage and give us some really great insights into collage and how he goes about that, because those of you who you would all know Gus's work would know that he has a very discreet and quirky way of using collage and I've loved watching his style develop over the years. So that's June in the duck pond. We've got Gus Gordon. July, we've got Mitch Vain. That's just going to be amazing. And she's, of course, Mitch has got decades of experience And such an incredible work ethic. And she's also hilarious and a bit evil. And I mean that in the nicest possible way. So I'm very excited about Mitch's class in July. And then some of you might have seen on the Facebooks, because I was busting to share, in August we've got Jackie French. And I mean, wow, hey? A masterclass with Jackie French. And I thought August is a perfect time. It's, you know, traditionally that's book week. It's a busy time for us all. It's kind of like the kid lit month, isn't it? It's not just book week, it's book month. And so it felt really right to have Jackie French do the masterclass in August. So beyond that, we're in negotiation, of course, with lots of other creators. We constantly, Manda, who's the community host, Manda and myself, we always work about 6 months in advance with the Duck Pond. So we're constantly in, Nerida says evil's good. Yeah, we're constantly in negotiation and discussion, not negotiation, but discussion with lots of masterclass hosts and stuff. So we try to keep, you know, keep ahead of things, and also gauging what's going on in the pond, gauging what we feel people need, trying to get that lovely balance between illustrators and writers, and those of course like Gus Gordon who do both. Yeah, so it's really a lot of fun to do that and to keep the pond really, really interesting and alive and diverse. We're always looking at diversity and moving some of our Duck Pond interviews towards that as well. Inclusivity, discussing all those sorts of things. So everything's there. We're working on it all. We're bringing it all together. For those of you who don't know Manda, Manda is my virtual assistant, my VA, and she's also the community host in the Duck Pond. And she comes from, she's had a lot of experience. I met her back at HarperCollins when she was a publicist back there, and she helped me out a lot. So Manda knows publishing quite well from the other side. She's also studying children's literature at university as well, while she's living in Seoul in Korea. So it's all very interesting, it's a great community. I'm super, super proud of it. And those of you who are thinking about jumping in, jump in. You can come in for a month. You know, you can come in for a month. It's a pay as you go, or you can pay a year's membership and just check it out for a year. But you can just come in for a month, see if you like it, see, you know, see if it suits you, and just test the water in the pond. There's no need to make a year-long commitment if that doesn't suit you. And also, you know, if you're not in a financial position where you have $300 at your disposal, but you know, you reckon you can dig together 30 bucks. Then come in and have a month of splashing around and getting to know everybody. Remembering also that there are masterclasses stored in the guides within the group, so you can go back and so Deb's is still will be there for 6 weeks, and I think Janie Godwin's is still there too for anyone who's coming in. Plus all the interviews that I've done so far, they're always available, and loads of other stuff, loads of other stuff in there for everybody. So that's what's going on. So the pond, of course, again, is open until tomorrow night at 9 o'clock, at 10 o'clock, Australian Eastern Standard Time. Monday night we close the cart at 10 p.m. And I'm not sure when we're going to open again. Every time we open the duck pond, it's a lot of back end work. So it's usually it feels like it's getting into a pattern of every 3 months, but I'm not sure about that. Don't quote me on that. There's lots of there's lots of excitement coming on here about the upcoming classes. All right, it's so great to hang out. I love hanging out on a Sunday, but I do know that you know, it's Sunday, and we like to have some space. Emma, thank you. Behind me, I think you can see Emma's new picture book there. Wonderful Shoes, which is coming out. So gorgeous, absolutely gorgeous. Illustrated by Tanya McCartney. What a beautiful team. Two fashionistas together. I mean, Tanya McCartney and Emma Bowd together. That's a bit of a team. So very excited to see that book coming out. Nadine says, can you renew if you join for a month? Yes, you can. Yes, you can. But we are factoring in, of course, you can't just join for a month, go away, come back and, pick and choose like that. There is a limit to that, Nadine. But you can do it twice. All right? You can do it twice. But and it's on Wonderful Shoes is on Emma's is on Bernie's list. Yeah. Yes, but of course, Nadine, you can join, leave, come back and join again. Absolutely. I'll just hang here and see if there's any more questions about everything that's going on. Oh, and the other thing that I did want to say to the duckies that are in the duck pond, remember that we have a full moon. We get into a little bit of woo in the pond because it's great fun. So we have a full moon coming up on the 29th, and I will be in and I'll do a live and I'll do the oracle reading again, like we did last full moon with a creativity oracle. It was such a lot of fun. People got to choose their card of the month, and I did a reading for each of the cards, and it was just really fun and inspiring. And so we have that creativity deck just for the duck pond, and I don't use it anywhere else, so it's good fun. And it helps people, it opens little portals of thought for people, helps them to think about where they're at in their journey. So it's just another part of, supporting our creators and having fun along the way and staying stimulated and open to new ideas. So, hey, we worked it out. We were in a, you know what? We were in a Facebook abyss when I tried to start today, weren't we? We're in a Facebook abyss, but we believed in ourselves. We got our mindset right, and we found a way through so that we could have this live. And Jodie's painting while she's listening. I love that. That's beautiful, Jodie. Yeah, so we got to do it. We got to do it, and it's now nearly 3 o'clock. So that's about an hour of faffing around on a Sunday afternoon. I am actually standing down what do you call it? A chest of drawers at the moment out in the shed. So I'm going to go and put my old tracky dacks on again and get out there and get back to my sanding and my reviving of this chest of drawers. I've got some of that. Is it French milk paint or whatever it is? It's who knows what it's going to turn out like. But anyway, it's a lot of fun. All right, I'm going to love you all and leave you. And thank you so much for coming along today. It's been great fun. I love hanging out with you all. I love talking about Kid Lit. I love talking about writing and illustrating. I love this community. And I'll see you all again back in here and over there and all around the traps very, very soon. Okay, loads of love. Have a great rest of the day. Bye for now.